good morning, my name is John Ryan and today we're going to walk the walk. We're in Bray in County Wicklow and we're going to walk the Bray to Greystones Cliff Walk. And joining me is Councillor George Jones, who started the Friends of the Cliff Walk. Morning, George.
Morning, John.
Eugene Finnegan, who's also a councillor with Bray Town Council and also chairman of Bray Tourism. Eugene, morning to you. And finally, Philip Byrne, who's head of Coast Care, but also a Foilshire, Ireland trail guide, would that be? Tour guide, yeah, and local historian. Philip, to a lot of people who look like just a ruin, but there's a lot of history to this.
Yeah.
What is it exactly?
Raheena Cliff, yeah. Little Church of the Bell. It's a pre-Norman church, but over here to our right, between Raheena Cliff and the coast, there's reputedly St. Patrick's Well. But the church here now, I think the significance is, for me, it's the location of it.
Okay.
You know, whoever built it here, you know, appreciated the view just as we're appreciating it today. Do you know, it's something about it's secluded and yet it's very much in touch with nature.
Well, there's something to be seen here at all times of year. There are birds to be seen along the cliffs. In winter time, you can come and see wonderful storms here, which is a sight in itself. You never really know what you're going to find here. Sometimes you'll see dolphins, maybe the occasional seal. So it's a place for everybody. And whether you're a wildlife enthusiast, an artist, a photographer, or just somebody strolling along, it's just a wonderful place to walk. You know, you never really know what you're going to see. During the autumn and winter up to spring, you're quite likely to see the Brent geese, which come to us from the Canadian Arctic Islands, as they make their way from the Bull Island down to their feeding grounds in Kilcool, and then back in the evening because they go back to Dublin for the nightlife. You really need to be blind not to appreciate a place like this. And it's just, even if you just want to walk and relax and look at the sea and look at what's happening and even listening, because very often our people don't actually listen. And the sounds that you hear along here, whether it's the sea or whether it's the actual birds, there are magical sounds to be heard.
Yeah.
There's a nice kind of viewing panel here. The council club recently, we'll have a look at. It's a photograph out over the bay. You've got the Dublin Mountains off over here, the town, the esplanade run along here, the harbour, Killiney Hill, Docky Island, and then Howth.
This walk actually has the rail line right beside us.
You can't talk about the cliff walk without talking about the railway, because it was the railway, which is where I'm looking, it was the railway that actually built the cliff walk. In the mid-19th century. See the track down there below?
Yeah.
If you were going to put a railway line from Bray to Wicklow, the very last place you'd put it is around the cliff walk. But when the railway was being built, Lord Meath didn't want his estate bisected by the railway. And if you got the railway to Shankill, if you went up in a helicopter, the natural route for a railway from Shankill to Wicklow is down through the Gleather Downs.
Okay.
It's a natural cutting.
Yeah.
But of course, that would mean that his
land would be.
Yeah. Yeah. So he gave them this route free.
Okay.
But because of the geology, the planes of the rocks side slide a lot. It still is one of the most costly parts of track to maintain.
And so, does it have some of the longest bridges I've been told?
It has about a mile long tunnel now, but that wasn't there in the original build.
Okay.
That was as a result of erosion and having to move the track in further. But we'll see that as we go along the walk.
Perfect, great.
Well, this particular section around Bray Head was an engineer's nightmare. You're coming literally around the shelf of a cliff on the Irish Sea, and environmentally it was very, very difficult. Access was very, very difficult. And remember, you had no machinery. It all came out by hand, you know? So you had all of those problems. And then in 1867, you had the first derailment, which, of course, everyone was saying was going to happen anyway. And luckily, nobody was killed. But 2 years later, there were two fatalities when the Enniscorthy to Dublin train, because the line had only got to Enniscorthy, when that was going round more or less the same place called the Ram Scalp, on a very, very sharp curve, it derailed. Now, it fell about 30 feet, but it didn't fall on the seaside, thanks be. Yet a man was killed on site and a lady died later. And very, very hard, you know, a lot of people injured, and very, very hard to get people out of that situation, you know, given the times that were in it. Well, railway tourism is as old as the railway itself. I mean, the Dublin and Wicklow weren't behind the door any more than any of the others. The Cliff Walk was their idea of yet another tourist attraction to bring people out to, you know, taste of fresh air, because at that time a lot of people thought fresh air was the answer to everything, you know.
So right now, we're coming up to what looks like a ruin, but this used to be a cottage.
Yeah, and this wall here that goes up along, that's the Bray town boundary. There was originally a gate lodge, and the gate just down there, that was where you'd pay a toll of a penny to walk the Cliff Walk to Lord Mead, except on Fridays where it was closed completely for his lordship's own use. If you look at the stone that's in that, building here is very difficult.
Yeah.
You've got to bring everything out, either now by rail track or carry it along the path. The only stone that's been brought out has been the granite pillars and the red brick. All the rest is stone that would have been quarried here locally.
Well, back around 2004, the council, both councils, Bray and Wicklow, had historically closed off the Cliff Walk continuously for years, and people never knew whether it was open or closed. And when we formed the Friends of the Cliff Walk in 2004, there was a huge amount of public support. We had had meetings in Bray and Greystones, which were attended by over 200 people in each venue. But while it was closed, again it was being used, in particular by international people. People from all over the world walked it.
We've just come around the corner now, and that's kind of our last view of Bray and South County Dublin and the like. And this is, I have to say, this is my favourite view of the classic Cliff Walk view, really, isn't it, into Greystones.
Absolutely.
Tell us, where we are now, there was smuggling done here.
Oh, there was,
ago,
absolutely.
There?
Yeah.
What's the history?
We're at what's known as the Brandy Hole. And this is where they smuggle in brandy, silks, and wine from France. And where the railway track runs now, there actually used to be a cave. They'd bring the stuff into the cave, and there was a shaft from the floor of the cave up to the path. Because, as you're saying, we're leaving Bray and coming into Greystones, this particular point was out of sight of both.
Okay.
So the coast guards in both ends couldn't see. So if there was a schooner offshore, the small boats could come in and get the gear ashore.
Fantastic.
So the Brandy Hole. Yeah, so we're talking about the rocks being on stable, but I mean, they've been here for 500 million years, and the instability is really only a problem if you're trying to tunnel through it. And, you know, CIE has done lots of work to stabilise the rock.
It's like this fencing here.
And up above us here where they've sprayed concrete on it.
So that makes sure that those rocks aren't going to go anywhere. I mean, so it is quite safe.
Yeah, I mean, there's no, really absolutely no safety risks from people walking.
And I think the thing is that the town councils, both in Greystones and Bray, regularly keep a check on it to make sure that it's safe.
You know, and yeah, I mean, there has been a couple of occasions where there has been landslides, in which case the path is just closed off.
Okay, so just again, we've met some more people walking the Cliff Walk today. Your own name?
Peter McKim, and this is Frank Sexton.
Hi, Frank.
And Liam O'Riordan and Owen Fox.
Great.
We've been walking this row this way for the last, as you see, we're not youngsters. So we've been walking here for about the last 50 years.
50 years?
On and off, yes.
Great. What do you think of the walk?
We think it's fabulous. And the interesting thing about the walk is that over the years, when we came here first, you'd meet nothing but locals.
Yeah.
In the last, probably in about 15 years, we've suddenly discovered that most of the people we meet, certainly 50% of them, consistently throughout the year, in fact, are foreigners.
Absolutely.
And all loving it. And it is a wonderful walk, and it's a great treat, and obviously a fantastic tourist opportunity. And in fairness to the council, just walking along here now, we've seen they've done a lot of work to improve it.
Sure.
That's a good thing, because it could have fallen into disuse.
Well, 50 years of walking it has kept you well and fit, so congratulations.
Let's
and keep doing it for another 50.
Cheers. Don't worry, John.
Yeah, Cable Rock, the one just up here, it's just jutting out. It's called Cable Rock because just off from it, there are submerged rocks and it's a navigation hazard. And the standard drill was to keep one cable's length off it. You know, you can only see the actual rocks that are the hazard at low water. So, I mean, even now, it looks perfectly safe. You could come in very close, but you tear the bottom off a ship. That, as a matter of interest, that point there too, was where the lookout point was during the World War, Second World War. There was a whole ring of local observation posts, they called them, around the coast, starting from Carlingford Lock and working all the way around the coast. Number 8 was the one here. And it was manned 24 hours a day, 265 days a year. Originally they were located in tents. And in 1942 they built a standard concrete structure. Can you imagine being out here all in tents? Yeah. And during about 1943, they actually painted the number of each post with rocks on the land and the word ERA. And it was done as a navigation aid for American aircraft. So our neutrality was a bit selective in that.
This is, I suppose, one of the places that really is the most attractive on the cliff walk. The fact that it's such a wilderness walk, it's out of sight. We're out of sight of Bray. We haven't come into sight of Greystones yet. We could be thousands of miles from civilization. Fantastic scenery. Lots of history. All the railway cuttings and all of that. The wildlife. Where even if we stand here, we're watching cormorants perched on the rocks down there. And there's, as we saw earlier on, porpoises and kittiwakes. And it's so interesting. It's so remote. And I think there's such the attractiveness of it is the wilderness of it.
This point that we're at, about midnight on the 23rd of August 1923, a ship, the SS Classic, would have gone up here very quietly and was carrying the body of Michael Collins. They couldn't risk bringing him back to Dublin by land, so they used the ship, the Classic, to sail him from Cork up to the rest of the government were waiting on the docks, and he arrived about 3 a.m. So about midnight on the 23rd, Michael Collins would have gone past here.
It's also very appropriate that he used to spend a lot of his time
That's right.
in Greystones. And actually,
Absolutely.
The night before he went and negotiated the treaty, he actually had spent it in Lewis's hotel in Greystones.
That's exactly right. We're kind of moving now from the rocky part of Bray Head down on towards the soilier part of down there, right down. And you'll see behind me that there's a lot of erosion there, because that's glacial boulder clay. As the glacier would have moved down from through Glen Cree, it would have hit the rocks here and been pushed out around it. You see on the beach there, there's reinforcing piles. That was where the railway ran originally. And you can see just how far it's come in now. And there's been several realignments of the rail. So it's far enough in now to last, well, for certainly all our lifetimes and a few more after that. But it's a continual process, because there's nothing to hold that back. Once the sea will just keep taking it and pulling it back out. Beautiful.
Now again, on this side, as we come into Greystones, The accessibility of this walk is very clear. You can again use the Dart to get onto it, or you can use the Dublin bus who come by it at the harbour and drop you off, or of course there's ample car parking at the Greystones Harbour area itself. So again, it's easily accessible like the side from Bray. One of the problems on the Greystones then has this has been the part of the walk that has suffered the biggest erosion. Going back over the centuries, it's always been a road with, as you were explaining about the landslide erosion. But back in the 40s, we lost a whole row of houses down on the North Beach. And since then, it has always, I mean, the council have had to move the walk in about five times. And they finally now have reached a settlement with a landowner to move it in well in from the coast, which should preserve it for years to come.
Okay, we've made it to Greystones in just about an hour and a half. It's been a beautiful walk. Our thanks to all the people we met on the way for being so generous with their time and talking to us. We're now in Greystones. Your choice is you can go to Greystones Dart Station and go back to Bray and sample the delights there, or you can indeed have food here in Greystones. But once again, thanks a million for watching our walk on the Cliff Walk, and we hope you'll take the opportunity to walk the walk.